Building Green on BCTV is supported by BARDA.
Good morning and welcome to Building Green. My name is Bill Vitale. I'm your host. This program runs at 10:30, the second Tuesday, 10:30 a.m., the second Tuesday of every month. It's repeated several times throughout the month, and it can be streamed on the bctv.org YouTube channel, as can all the other great programming on BCTV. Welcome. Topic today is going to be Bernhart's Dam, and my guest, who seems to know a lot about it, as you'll find out, is Bethany Ayers Fisher, and Bethany is the sustainability manager for the city of Renton. She's been in that capacity for several months, but she has been in the public works department. Correct me if I'm wrong, that your previous position was in public works. I'm going to say for 2 or 3 years, but she can clarify that. Anyway, Bethany, welcome. Go ahead.
And
before you're supposed to say, oh, it's great to be here.
It is great to be here. and thank you for having me. Yeah, I started with the city back in 2019 as the environmental educator, and was promoted to sustainability manager in December of 2021.
Okay, so, all right. So since you've started a little bit of talking about who you are, let's just get a little bit of your background, maybe describe, you know, the position you're in and your, and I think it's fitting to say your passion for this, because there's definitely passion for these issues. Let's talk about that for a second, and then we'll do it. Then you can kind of maybe roll into some of the big picture kinds of things that really impact today's topic and why we think it matters. So go ahead.
Yeah. So, I actually am a newcomer to Reading. I grew up in Northeast Ohio, near the Cuyahoga River, and, with my family. And I moved out here in 1998 for a job opportunity. And we have remained here in Berks ever since. Well, the kids have moved on to bigger and better things, but my kids were raised here in Berks County. And in 2014, I had the opportunity to go back to school full time, and I took it. And I basically have had the best midlife crisis ever. And I spent my 40s going to school, and decided to do something with the environment and people. I didn't want to be a nurse. I didn't want to go into medicine, things like that. And so I did my beginning studies at RAC, where I majored in anthropology and laboratory science. And then I transferred to Balvernia and graduated in 2018 with a bachelor's in environmental biochemistry and a minor in sustainability. And then I just finished up my master's in leadership and looking at sustainable communities and sustainable community development. And the opportunity in 2019 came up to join the city, and I was very excited that I got chosen, and I love it, absolutely love it. There's a lot of awesome opportunities in Reading, and there's a lot of assets in Reading where, compared to other cities, we actually have some really good resources to draw upon, not only for now, but for the future. So I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen, because I like pictures.
Bethany, just can you just, say a couple of things about your position, the sustainability manager.
Sure. So my position is to help the city look at different issues from multiple sides. So when we're looking at, when we're talking about sustainability, we look at the economic side of things, we look at the social side of things, and we look at the environmental side of things. And we try to fit everything into a sweet spot. And then when we find that sweet spot, then we look at something being sustainable. So in my position, I am charged with energy efficiency and transition for the city. So not only at Public Works, where we deal with the operations and the infrastructure of the city, but helping all of our departments kind of bring in this philosophy. So energy transition and energy efficiency. I work with all parts of the water system. So our drinking water system in with Rawa, our wastewater treatment plant and wastewater sewer system, and then also our stormwater system. And then I also work with our solid waste department. So everything with trash recycling, how do we make those systems more efficient? How do we reduce what we're putting into our landfills? And how do we help create that circular economy that good recycling programs rely on? And then also with mobility, so how do we get around our city? What are our future needs going to look like transportation-wise? And then how can I support those efforts in the city? And then everything comes down to public health and quality of life. If it's not making a healthy city with people who want to be involved with things, none of these things are going to work well. And then also our economic and community development. So what kinds of things do we have? What kind of jobs do we have? What kind of opportunities for education and recreation do we have? So I get to kind of play in all of the sandboxes and build a great big sandbox for all of us to work in. I'm going to share my screen so that way I can give some visuals on how this all works. Okay, so Bill, you should be able to see my screen now.
Yep.
So sustainability actually has a definition, and it was developed in 1987 at the United Nations Brundtland Commission. And it's defined as meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. And living in such a historical city as Reading, we look around and we know that everything that we live with today were decisions that were made 20 years ago, 50 years ago, 100 years ago, 200 years ago, 250 years ago, 275 years ago. These things still affect us today. And the decisions that we make will affect future generations. Not only with what kind of assets they have, but also what kind of assets they don't have. So we are all very cognizant, especially in Public Works, when we're dealing with our large infrastructure, of making sure that we are meeting today's needs, but also we are very cognizant of the decisions that we make are going to affect the future. So I'm going to move ahead a second. And so some of the different things that we're working on is our climate resiliency and sustainability plan. And this is in a draft form and has been for several years. We've been going through a lot of shocks and transitions over the last few years. So it kind of gets worked on and then put aside and worked on again. And so we're hoping to get a final draft completed to go to public comment and then be adopted by City Council and the administration by the end of the year. And the parts of the climate resiliency and sustainability plan include our energy efficiency and transition, waste management, water management, mobility, public health and quality of life, community and economic development, with the understanding that all six of these kind of buckets are all interrelated. And we can't have essentially nice things without making sure that we're taking care of these six things as a community. Because the city is not a company, and a lot of the sustainable development things actually came out of what companies can do. So I've adopted them for what local governments can do. And our job as stewards, as a city employee, we are the stewards of our resources. So it is people, prosperity, and planet. And we have to make sure that things are viable, equitable, and bearable. And above all, we have to make sure that our purposes, like the whys that we're doing things, actually meet as many needs as possible. And then the direct projects that I'm involved with right now, of course, is energy. Energy is a hot topic right now. There's a lot of things going on. That's a topic for another day. Public land stewardship, our MS4, which is stormwater, wastewater treatment plant, and then waste management. So lots of different buckets. But today we're talking about Bernhart. And this is a screenshot of an aerial map.
Bethany, before we go, I want to get into the Bernhart Dam, but I just want to add a couple of things to what you've said.
Sure.
First of all, that the position, just so people out there, I mean, I hope from what Bethany has just said that viewers recognize if people think that Reading is somehow not on the ship that is dealing with sustainability, or somehow, you know, we're a backward city and we're not thinking about this stuff. This position was created, I believe it was put into the budget in 2021 or maybe even 2020, so that we have a staff person dedicated to the work that Bethany just went over. I mean, I kind of find it comforting that's there. Also, this thinking about the six buckets that Bethany talked about, you know, that's new in a sense in terms of Reading. There was a time when things weren't regarded in a comprehensive way that way, even though we did master plans and tried to put everything in. And I think what she has gone over is not her looking at this in isolation. It's really the department and the administration and council are on board with this. The city passed a climate action, a resolution 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago, to commit, move the city to 100% clean energy. And that's what the climate resiliency and sustainability plan is really a building on that. And when Bethany says it's going to go out for public comment, it is not just going to be window dressing. The intent is to have public input and have this plan kind of built. There's already been a fair amount of public input, but to actually get more input more broadly is like, how do these issues, what do these mean to people, and what matters to people? So I don't want to belabor that. We could have a separate program to discuss all that. But anyway, that, all of that, and I asked Bethany to kind of do this because the reason I wanted to have her discuss Bernhart's Dam and building green is because it is very much a part of this big picture. So take it away, Bethany.
Okay. And Reading isn't the only city doing this either. There's about 60 cities across the Commonwealth and just in Pennsylvania working on these same issues. And we talk all the time. So it's a good thing. So Bernhart, Dan, this is a screenshot that I took this morning off of Google Maps. And this shows the dam in place. And it's about a 25-acre reservoir. And then it's got quite a bit of development around it. And then this is actually part of Mount Penn. So this is just north of Mount Penn. The Bernhart Creek is formed from springs coming off of Mount Penn. This is Route 12 right here, and this is Spring Valley Road. And then this site we will discuss later on, but this is the old battery factory that has a great impact on the reservoir.
And you want to just point out where the dam is? It's kind of...
the dam is right here.
Right. And then
so, and then we have... And Bernhart Stream's kind of unique because it's what we call daylight. So it's exposed to daylight through here. And then right off of the screen, it's actually piped underground. And then it goes out to the Schuylkill River in Northwest Reading. Actually pretty just on the other side of the baseball stadium is where it outfalls. So this is a picture pre-remediation process of the dam. So the dam was originally built in 1796. George Washington was still president. And it was built as a grist mill. So it was used to grind grain. It was hydroelectric power. And then John Bernhart acquired the mill in 1832. That's how it got its name. And he made the dam bigger, built a new mill, and then continued to expand it until 1853. In 1865, the city acquired the dam to use as a water supply. Reading was just beginning to boom, and we did not have enough fresh, clean water in the city. And this is when people started getting indoor plumbing. So Reading was built before we had indoor plumbing. And then as we started to develop that technology, which really did help things like people from dying from dysentery, typhoid, cholera, really devastating diseases that we really don't see today because of clean water supplies. And then in 1868, the city decided to expand the dam again and build a new dam. And this is the dam that exists today. So, and the completed dam, the last expansion that was done in 1868, would hold between 40 million and 50 million gallons of water. The kind of castle-looking structure here in the center of the picture is where the valve house is. And so there were valves that people could open and close depending on how much water we need to go from. And then there's actually two 24-inch pipes in the dam. And one is about 11 feet below the surface level. And then one is another 13 feet below. So the dam itself, or the lake bed itself, is about 28 to 32 feet below the surface of the water. This is a pre-construction photo of the breach of the dam. In the 1930s, in the 1920s, we built Lake Ottolani because Bernhart and Angelica and some of the other reservoirs around the city were not big enough to supply the water needs of Reading. So in the 1920s, we built Lake Ottolani. That lake and system is the one that we currently use. Rawa is the managers and stewards of that asset for the city. And I do encourage anybody to go tour. You can book small group tours with Rawa to go tour the facilities, and I highly recommend that you do. And then, so it was taken offline in the 1930s. Also in the 1930s, the Bowers Battery Company was formed and was sited just to the northwest of the lake. And they made lead batteries, and then they were taken over in the 50s, I believe, by General Battery, and then later on by Exide Battery. And so they did lead smelting, and in the 1930s until the 1990s, there were no pollution controls on the factory. And so You remember from Gravity, you know, anything that goes up, it must come down. We ended up with lead contamination on the site. So the DEP.
John, we can hear the studio on air.
So in 2016, the DEP told us again, we have an issue with the dam. Again, it's a very, very old dam. We no longer had controls over the valves. And so we had worked with the DEP to come up with a plan to examine the dam. And part of that was going to be having to breach the spillway. So this photograph was taken on May 12th after the spillway breach was complete. It was started on April 25th. And we basically took the spillway down a foot a day. So we wanted to do a very slow, controlled breach of the dam. And you can see that we have a lot of stone here. There's brick here. And then clay. We don't have a whole lot of time, so I just kind of want to run through.
Bethany, a foot per day, totally how many feet? It in total it went down how many feet?
Off the top of my head, I want to say 18 feet.
Okay. That's good. Okay, that's fine.
Yeah. And then this was taken on June 10th. As you can see, we still have water. The dam is still there. But this pipe here is the first outfall. So the first pipe that would go into the old water supply system that is no longer there. These islands here, are suspected and expected to have lead in the soil. We have had the water tested multiple times over the years. It doesn't appear that the lead is actually in the water. And that has to do with the species of lead and the water chemistry of the lake. So that's a good thing. This was taken on May 12th. And you can see that the stream going through the area that was breached is still very muddy. Lots of particulates and sediments in the stream. And this is taken a month later and it's really clearing up. The water is very clear now. And yes, it looks like a giant mud puddle, but we are starting to see where the springs and the main stream are deciding that it wants to A, go and B, where the stream bed actually is. This was taken May 12th. Again, it's lots of ponds still and all of these little teeny tiny waterways. We do have stormwater. Stormwater pipes that drain into the area. And so this is one of the channels that it is making whenever we get a rainstorm. And then this is the backside of the lake. For those of you who are very familiar with the area, like if you grew up with it, back here is where the children's fishing pond was. But unfortunately that is all silted in from not being dredged for many years. And we can see the different branches of where the stream wants to go. This is what it kind of looks like right now. This would have all been underwater. So where the rocks and the tree branches are, we're all underwater. We actually didn't find a whole lot of debris in the lake. That doesn't mean it's not in the sediment, like it didn't sink and get covered, but we haven't found a whole lot of debris in the lake, which is a happy thing. And as we can see, we're starting to see here that the stream bed is starting to be visible. So the stream beds in Pennsylvania, especially in Berks County, are very gravelly and rocky. And so we're happy to see that we're starting to see the stream bed. This was taken June 2nd, and you know it's starting to dry out some, and we've got 4 minutes. And so, yes, it is a giant mud puddle right now. We are in the stages of looking at how are we going to manage the site? What are our opportunities for what we want to do with the site? And many of us are on the side of restoring the area as a floodplain and as fully as a park for recreation and for stormwater management.
Which would, in the end, still have a lake, but smaller.
Or no. Possibly. It's really going to depend on what things look like. And we'll get there. I do want to show Angelica Creek because we have done this before. Angelica Creek lost its dam in 2001. And this was about 2006, what it looked like. You're starting to get the meadow. Trees are being planted. It doesn't look like a mud pit anymore.
Can you go back a slide just to show the...
Let me go back. So this is Angelica used to look like, and this is what Bernhart currently looks like.
Right.
But when restoration...
It did look like that, right.
It did look like that. And then this is early on in the stages of restoration at Angelica. And this is what Angelica is looking like now. So you have a protected stream. It's nice and shaded. And this is what the wetland looks like. And that's what we're kind of looking at for Bernhart, but we are very much in the discovery stages and planning stages. I'm happy to answer questions. I'm happy to suggestions of what people would like to see at the park. Not really keen on getting screamed at. but you know, we do have a really good team. And it's a continuing project. We'll be happy to come and talk about it more as we know more information. But I also want to thank Lisa Adams from the Berks History Center and Joseph Webb from Go Reading Berks for providing us with a lot of background information on the dam as well. And then this is my contact information. If you have questions or, want to get involved, we'll be happy to get you involved. Hopefully we'll be getting some more updates by the end of the summer. And I'll be ready to come back end of summer, early fall with an update.
Okay, well, Bethany, that was great. I mean, you squeezed a lot into a short bit of time. I think this is a good sort of primer. I learned a lot. It's very informative. And as Bethany said, sometime a few months from now, we'll come back to this when we know more. But I just want to summarize what you said and reinforce that the group of folks that are looking at this are looking at it with long range thinking and what's best for the city, much as it was with Angelica. And to some extent, some of these things are prescribed by the state. So the maneuvering room for the city is not unlimited. But I think it's with the environment and the community in mind and creating a place that will have long-term use for folks. So Bethany, thank you very much. The next program for Building Green is on July 12th in this time slot, 10:30. I thank you for tuning in. And see you next month.
Building Green on BCTV is supported by BARDA.